everybody. My name's Chuck Jesp again, and today's copy and heaven series is going to be a little bit different topic than normal. Today we're going to talk about how to avoid being ripped off in the world of auto repair. And just to give you an idea, if you happen to be the proud owner of a Cadillac SRX, which I am also, you happen to have your headlight bulb go out on you, and you happen to go check around to try and get somebody to replace it, and you find out, guess what, they want to try and suck you into their shop and charge you anywhere from $200 on up to $400 or $500 just to replace a light bulb. This is what the world of automotive repair has turned into lately. So I decided we'll take the opportunity here to not only do a little how-to video on how to repair or replace this particular headlight bulb in this particular vehicle, which in my case is a 2008 Cadillac SRX all-wheel drive with the V8 engine in it. And now, one thing to take note of here is some of these cars were manufactured with halogen low beam and high beam headlights, and some of these cars were manufactured with what they call high intensity discharge headlights. If you have the halogen headlights and one of them happens to go out on you, it goes out. It has a filament in the bulb, and when it goes out, it goes out. It's either on or it fails to work. But if you've got a high intensity discharge system, it's possible for this bulb to fade out. In my case, I had white low beam headlights, and one day the right hand or passenger size bulb started fading to a bright pink. I noticed this because I have my headlights on all the time when I drive, and I pulled up behind a car ahead of me that was a black pickup truck, and I could see my lights, you know, reflecting on the back tailgate of the pickup, and one of them was white in the black reflected back end, and the other one was kind of a reddish color, and I'm like scratching my head like, what the heck? I'm gonna have to check that out when I get to the parking lot when the, you know, the grocery store I'm going to. And sure enough, I get out of the car, I go around, I look, the passenger size bulb is a little dimmer and it's turned a pink reddish color. That tells you that you've got the high intensity discharge. Of course, I didn't learn any of this until I started driving around to the auto parts places and trying to find somebody to swap it out. You'll notice with this high intensity headlight, this is the one that's bad. And if we go over here to the other side, you'll see that it's a whiter light, so it's still working good. But that's the whole reason for doing this project in the first place, is the headlights have started to go bad on the passenger side. But I'm going to replace both bulbs and hopefully not have to do this again in a month or two. Next thing I learned, you got to take the whole bumper off of the car just to get to the headlight containers or the headlights themselves, so you can pull them out and then open the back of them up and get your light bulb out. It's not like you can just pop the hood open, maybe undo a screw or two, get the headlight canister out and swap the bulbs out. It's not that easy. This particular car, like Mercedes, BMWs, and a lot of other cars that happen to have these kind of bulbs, they're often a pain to work on, and they've been designed by General Motors in this case to be a very expensive proposition. Give all your money to the service department for an hour or two of labor at $100 plus an hour, walk into the parts department, ask the parts department what they want. They tell you some stupid number like $300 for one single light bulb. And they chuckle and they think you're just going to shell out $200-$300 for a part, another couple hundred dollars if you decide you're going to change both sides, and they're going to, you know, end up with half of your bank account before it's all over with just to change one light bulb. So the smart thing to do is to locate two light bulbs at a reasonable price and figure out how to do it yourself, which is, this is what this video is all about, how to do it yourself, and go on down the road, maybe a total cost of $100 to $120. Okay, so what I'm going to do next here is tell you what tools you need, and then right after I tell you what tools, I'm going to do a quick slideshow showing you what part is involved in this case and the part numbers, and give you some of that information, and then I'll move into the actual how-to of how to pull the front end off of this particular Cadillac SRX and swap the bulbs out, and hopefully when you get to the end of the video you'll have everything you need to know. Now there are other videos out there showing you how to do this. I'm going to try and throw in a few tips and keep the tools that you're going to need down to something that most mechanics have in their toolbox and most do-it-yourself people might have in their toolbox. If you take this to a shop, obviously they're going to use some power tools and some other conveniences. This is all going to be manual. It's going to be the poor man's approach, and try to keep the whole cost of this project down to about an hour and a half of work on your part, and with a little luck, under $100, and get both light bulbs replaced so that you don't have to go through this again when the other side decides to burn out maybe another 100 hours from now. Keep in mind, both light bulbs are probably gonna burn out at about the same time, so it's better off if you can figure out how to replace them both while you've got the bumper off. Okay, so there's the introduction. Let's move on into the rest of the video and the how-to and the slides, and with a little luck you can get this done, like I said, in an hour to an hour and a half, using your own wits and your own mechanical abilities. Okay, now here's the tools that I'm going to use during this how-to video. This is not by any means a fixed set, but it's the ones that I find came in handy to perform this particular job. First off, you would either want a flathead screwdriver, or in this case I've got a chisel tool that I use. I found that this comes in pretty handy when it comes to removing and replacing rubber rivets, but you need something that you can wedge underneath the rivet center punch and pull it out, and then maybe get underneath the rivet itself to loosen it and pull it out. So that'll be your most important tool in this case. Next here, I've got a set of extensions. In my case, in order to reach the distance we need to go, I'm using a couple of my quarter inch extensions and a couple of my 3/8 inch extensions. And what I do is I will be using my 3/8 inch ratchet, my Craftsman, and in order to make the these extensions, connect them and make them long enough, I've got a 3/8 to 1/4 adapter, and then I've got a 1/4 back up to 3/8 adapter, which will allow me to attach my 3/8 inch 10 millimeter long deep socket. Okay, because we're going to have about 10 millimeter bolts that we'll be removing during this project. So by attaching the adapter to the 3/8 inch socket extensions here, and then attaching the 1/4 inch to that, and then necking it back up to 3/8 inch on the end, you're able to attach a 3/8 inch socket. But you can, of course, interchange these depending on the situation. But it basically, a couple of the bolts that are up underneath the front cover are a long ways up and hidden, and you need some extensions of some sort which are long enough to reach. In this case, the length would be probably about 2 feet. I've also got a 1/4 inch socket screwdriver, and I'm going to be attaching to that a T15, a number 15 Torx head screwdriver bit. So I'll be using that to open up the back of the headlight canister in order to actually remove the bulb. Now, I also keep handy a pair of needle nose pliers, which sometimes comes in handy. And putting the front end back together and lining up the holes, a thin Phillips screwdriver with maybe a long reach on it will come in handy. So round up those tools. You might want to round up a pair of couple pairs of rubber surgical type gloves that will allow you to operate without getting your hands dirty, or just some workman's gloves, whatever you like to use. Okay, so here's our car, and I'm going to try and do this the easy way, so we'll step you through it. First thing you're going to want to do is pop the lid and go ahead and open the hood. Now, I'm going to get under the car here, and hopefully I can get an angle on the plastic rivets that need to be removed on the underside of the car first. Start with the hard part first and work our way to the easy part next. So let's see if we can get a bead on these. You'll see there's one rivet there that's got an X by it, and there's another one that's missing on this car a little further back, and then there's another one here with an X by it. So, one on the front lip does not need to be removed, and one near the outer edge also does not need to be removed. And the rest of them across the bottom here will also have to come out all the way across to the other side. Again, the two on the opposite side will not need to be removed. So we'll do that first. Now, once you get those removed on the bottom, then you'll want to take out these rivets on the top, this one bolt, and go all the way across the top, removing all these rivets. And this one's just a spare. You don't need to remove it if there happens to be one in there. But you need to remove the rivets that are actually attaching the front bumper to the car. This is just a rubber stop for the hood. You don't need to worry about that. But you do need to remove the rubber rivets, which we'll show you how to do that in a moment after removing the lower rivets. Now there's also three rivets inside the wheel well that hold the back edge of the front bumper to the inside of the wheel well. There's one at the bottom about here, there's one a little ways up right there, and then there's a third one up at the top. Those will also have to be removed in the same fashion as the other rivets across the top or the ones on the bottom across the lower front edge. Okay, now I'm gonna remove a few of the rivets from the top driver's side of the car, and I'll show you how that was done. Same way it was done underneath, so it's pretty straightforward. Start here by the headlight. Just get underneath the edge with your screwdriver or your lever. Pop the center out, or at least release it far enough. Then just pull the rivet out, and it's pretty simple. Some of them are a little tighter than others, depending on how tight they're in the hole. But usually they come out with a little bit of gentle prying. And if you have to pull the center piece out, go ahead and pull the center piece out. Just make sure you don't lose them. Put them back together before you set them down. And they'll go right back in later on when you're ready to reassemble the bumper. Try to remember where you put them all. So I'm working my way across one side, across the other side. That's step number two. Now step number three is getting the rivets inside the wheel well. I'll show you that in a minute. Which, by the way, you're going to want to turn the steering wheel. So at this point, turn the engine on, but don't have any parts on top of the engine when you do it. And no tools on top of the engine when you do it. And go ahead and turn the engine on. Crank the wheel hard right so you can get to the driver's side wheel. Crank the wheel hard left so you can get at the passenger side wheel. Okay, now you'll notice the tire is turned right so that it opens up a gap there that gives you more room to operate. And now you should be able to pull out the three rivets along the inner edge here of the front bumper cover. There's a bolt holding it in here, and there's a nut holding it with a bolt type rivet down in here. So before you can separate that, you're gonna have to get up under there and release both the bolt and the rivet. The rivet nut, the nut on the rivet, the front one, only needs to be loosened so that the rivet will release off of the fender, as we'll show you when we get it apart. The bolt is probably better to take it all the way out. Okay, you might notice here if I zoom in that the three flanges that are the same color as the body color here are now behind the black plastic inner wheel liner. That's because I've separated it. So now at this point, I'm going to use a flashlight or a shop light and go up from below
and try to locate and remove the nut and the nut on the rivet bolt, and I'm also going to try and remove the bolt, both of which I can do with extensions, a Craftsman socket wrench, and the 10 millimeter long reach socket, which I told you about earlier. Okay, so I'm opening it up here so I can get access to it. This is flexible, you don't need to worry about it breaking. It's harder than heck to break. Just open it up, see if you can locate your first bolt, which is right in here, and take it off. And remember the old rule, righty tighty, lefty loosey. Once you get it loose, you can pretty much just take it off by hand. Okay, so here I've got the bolt out. Hopefully you can see that. And just a typical bolt with its own washer on it. Don't lose it. And now I'm going to go forward and try to release the rivet nut. Doesn't even look like I'm going to need a flashlight. It's got enough light here today. This is the reason you need the about 2 feet of extension, because the rivet nut is right in about here. So now it's starting to loosen up. And hopefully you can hear what I'm saying here. So I've got that loose. And I'm not going to take it all the way off. Now, the next thing you need to worry about is to, you want to do the same thing to the other side. But one thing to note is you're going to do the exact same thing on the other side after turning the wheel the opposite way. And once you've got that done, you do not want to drop this on the ground too hard, mess it up, scratch it or whatever. Nor do you want to pull it too far away from the car, because you might have headlight washers where there will be some washer fluid tubes running to the headlight boxes, in which case you want to be careful not to yank those out and cause a leak or whatever. Okay, so as you can see, I've got the wheel cranked the other way, and I'm going to pull the same three plastic rubber rivets out of this side, and then I'm going to go up there and remove the bolt and remove the nut off of the bolt rivet. You can see I've separated the fender on the left side, or on the passenger side here, and you'll notice this is where the bolt came out of, this particular bolt, and this is up front here. I'm pointing is the rivet, which has a nut attached to the bottom. I'll show you why you need to leave that nut on the bolt. You'll also notice that up underneath here, if we can get an angle on it, this bolt rivet goes up through that hole, and as you assemble it, the rivet slides back in the groove. If I can get a shot of that, back in that groove, then you tighten it down. At that point, the edge of the front fender is lined up with the edge of the front bumper, or the bumper is, the bumper is lined up with the fender, however you want to call it. The screw, on the other hand, has to go up into a threaded screw hole right back in here. So once everything's lined up, you'll be able to get the bolt up into the hole from below, and the rivet can then be tightened, and once the rivet is tightened, it'll clamp into the groove here and hold the fender firmly to the front bumper firmly to the fender from below. So there's no real reason to take that nut off of that rivet type bolt all the way. It's just important to loosen it so it'll slide out and drop down. Now let's go ahead and back off here, and I'll drop that front bumper onto the ground, hopefully without a whole lot of hassle. Okay, so there's some rubber insulation. Anyway, you had to kind of pull it out and then drop it down. Okay, I'm going to show you why you don't want to pull the bumper too far away from the car, hopefully. If we go right down in here, you'll notice there's a wire harness that only reaches so far when the bumper's taken off. So you don't want to pull it too far and mess that up. Likewise, on the other side, there's another wire harness, as well as down below here, you can see some of the other plumbing that is also leading to the headlight washers, etc. So you want to be careful not to upset the apple cart, take any of that off while you're at it. Okay, this is the harness connector. It's kind of, if you don't know what you're doing, you have to futz with it for a while to get it off. But basically, you can just press down on this lever, and what it does is it releases the inside clip. I don't know if you can see it moving up and down there. But that's, while you're holding that down with your thumb or finger, then you can pull the harness connector out. And the harness connector, of course, connects in here, getting the getting that little clip to release off of the notch here is the trick of the trade when it comes to releasing that harness. After you get that headlight out, then same thing on the opposite side over on the passenger side, which in this case is where the bad light bulb is. Okay, so I'm going to again release three bolts, one down below and two up above, to take out the passenger side light fixture. Okay, one more thing to note. Of these three bolts, the top one on the outside is a longer one. The other two, the one that hooks to a plastic support bracket and the one that goes down below to the metal bracket, are both shorter. So when you go to put things back together, remember which bolts go where. And another tip about this, by the way, is it's best if once you pull the headlight out, to go ahead and re-thread the bolts so you don't lose them. So I'm going to go ahead and pause and do that, and I'll show you where I re-threaded them when I got done. Now, something else I wanted to point out is you'll notice that the bolt, the longer one, right up here, also has a little clip. That bolt threads into that clip. When you take the headlight off, make sure that clip doesn't get displaced and lost. There's a similar clip down in the lower bolt on the headlight container. So you do not want to lose those clips, or you won't have anything to thread your bolts back into. Anyway, once you're done pulling the headlight out, just go ahead and put the bolts back in to the holes they came out of. That way you won't lose them while you're working on swapping out the light bulb. Okay, the next step is to remove the back covers off of each of your light bulb containers or your headlamps. And to do that, you have to remove the three Torx screws. So you got one here, and one hiding down below. A Basically, you've got to remove the back of both of them if you're going to replace both headlights. And you'll notice I'm wearing rubber gloves. It's a good idea to wear rubber gloves from at least this point of the operation on, because you do not want to touch the glass bulbs. And if one of them, such as the driver's side in this case, is good, you'll probably want to save it for later. And you don't want to put any of your hand oil, any of your oil off your hand on these bulbs if you ever end up using them. They'll overheat and burn out quicker. So do not touch the light bulb itself with your bare hands. Another thing to note is these Torx screws are screwing into plastic threaded holes. You don't want to over tighten them when you go to put them back together, and you don't want to cross thread them, so be careful about that. Okay, so this is what it looks like with the back removed, and I'm going to zoom in here and you'll see what the factory bulb looks like. So there's the factory bulb. You'll notice there's a wire clip which you have to release in order to be able to take the bulb out, and then you're going to have to unplug the wire harness from the connector on the back of the bulb here on the ballast. The square portion of the bulb is the ballast, so I'll go ahead and do that. Pretty easy to release. Then you just unplug this, and with a little luck, your bulb will just slide right out. This is the bad one, so I'm going to set it aside. And again, same thing for the other side. Okay, here's a couple of the Sylvania D1S replacement bulbs. You'll notice they're 35 watt, if you can see that at the top right corner of the box. They're the HID Xenon Sylvanias, and I'll pop one out of the box just to show you the difference between the original and the back cover. And we might have to do a couple photos later and add them on at the end of the show here. Okay, so I bought these Sylvanias, and they say Osram on them, as we noted before, Osram being the parent company of Sylvania. Okay, that's about as good as we're going to get. Notice the Osrams are 66144s, and the original ones are 66043s. So there is a difference in the part number on the bottom, but effectively the Osram 66144 should be bright white bulbs once they're replaced. So I'm going to go ahead and put everything back together. I think you get the idea on the teardown. I'll probably do a couple of small short clips here on tricks of the trade putting it back together, but basically going back together should be reverse order and reverse everything of taking it apart. And if I think there's a couple other tricks here, I'll let you know as we go, so hang in there. Okay, so this is what it looks like when I got the first bulb in the driver's or passenger side in. What I wanted to note here, and I almost forgot to tell you, the container that holds these has little flanges. You might see about 2, 4, 6, 8 of them across the top, a couple on each side, and a couple on the bottom. So as you plug the bulb in, those will grip and clamp onto the ballast. So again, it takes a little bit of pressure to get that bulb back in there, but it should snap in. Try not to break anything in the process. Okay, I'm going to show you on the second bulb what I mean about plugging it into the holder. One more thing. There are 3 pins in the connector, and so there's only one right way to connect the harness to the connector. Make sure you don't try to force it on the wrong way. 2 pins on one side, 1 on the other side, line them up correctly and plug them in. cake, see? Okay, now it's just a matter of putting the back covers back on with the three torque screws, as I mentioned at the start of the video, and then we'll be ready to go and start reassembling everything. One more quick note. Remember, if you do have a good one that you're swapping out and you want to keep it as a spare, you might mark that box good, and the bad one you might want to put in a separate box and mark it with bad, or you know, try not to cross them up and throw away the good one and keep the bad one. So another good tip to think about. Okay, one other thing to think about when you're putting the headlights back together, the bolt that is in the top that connects to the rubber flange that you see here, I guess you'd call it the one near the hood bump stop. When you're putting that headlight back on, you need to make sure that you don't lose your high and low beam adjustment by putting the headlight on a little bit crooked. So you'll notice that there's a metal washer on this bolt, and if you line that washer up with a circular pattern on the plastic, good chance you will still have your headlights adjusted about right. The same can be said for the bolt that's a little farther back, closer to the hood. So you can't see it in this picture, it's behind the rubber seal there. I'll point to it. I'm back here. So the bolt that's behind the rubber seal, it's the one that goes into a little clip, threaded clip. That one's going to be a little harder to figure out where the alignment should be, but the bottom line is try to make sure that as you install your headlight, you know, everything is halfway snug on the rubber seals down the front of the car here, for example. So if you get it in there nice and firm and line up the pattern on the bolt, hopefully you'll have good adjustment. Okay, since I don't have a helper, I'm going to have to hang this bumper back on there myself. But one thing I wanted to note is after lifting the bumper up, keep a couple of the rubber rivets handy in your hand, and then go ahead and drop it on there and put the rubber rivets in and hold the bumper in the middle up here by the hood latch is probably the best place to hold it on while you're trying to reassemble the rest of them. So that's another tip to be aware of. The battery on the camera is going dead, so this is probably going to be the end of the movie until I throw a couple pictures in at the end later on. One last note before I wrap this up. After you get the bumper hanging with a couple rivets up top, go ahead and reassemble the two nuts and bolts under here. Make sure that, again, that everything is in the slots and lined up before you start tightening things up. It's easier if you reassemble these pieces before the bumper is on too tight with too many rivets. Okay, over and out.